We're going to pick up here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to look at verses 3 through verse 6. So just to, again, appreciate the context, I'll begin reading at verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Ye know that ye were Gentiles, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. Wherefore, I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. As we pick it up here now at verse 3, what Paul is going to begin to do is provide some evidences to determine whether anyone who professes to possess the spiritual gifts are truly empowered by the Spirit of God, or rather, they're operating in the realm of the flesh. So we're going to look at these evidences in the next few weeks, again, to determine if the gifts are being driven by the flesh or if they're being driven by the Spirit of God. We can call it tests of authenticity. That's what Paul's going to do. He's going to provide some tests of authenticity to help the believer distinguish whether someone really is empowered by the Holy Spirit in relationship to the spiritual gifts, or one is actually a fraud and a counterfeit, okay? So as we begin here at verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed. So here's going to be the first test, the first evidence. And frankly, what verse 3 is going to do is going to provide a test of authenticity using the measure of sound doctrine. And that's going to be critically important here. The first test involves, what does the individual claiming to possess the gifts, what kind of doctrine are they going to be teaching? In fact, why don't we kind of understand where these evidences are located. Verse 3, evidence number 1, or test number 1, sound doctrine is going to be the measure of authenticity. Secondly, verses 4 through 6, Paul's going to emphasize unity among the Godhead. And the reason he's going to do that is he's going to demonstrate that unity is one of the core elements that, by the way, is lacking here at Corinth. In fact, verses 4 through 6, Paul's going to emphasize unity among the Godhead, and then Paul's going to amplify that, verses 12 and following the rest of the chapter. He's going to apply the issue of unity in relationship to the body of Christ. So in other words, is what is happening at Corinth resulting in unity, or is it resulting in division? Okay. Another evidence, obviously in verse 7 through verse 11, the Apostle Paul is going to demonstrate that these gifts are intended to profit others. These gifts are never intended to be self-serving. So another evidence, whether one is truly being led by the Spirit, whether one truly is driven by the Holy Spirit, will result in the gifts being exercised for the spiritual benefit of others. Another area will be, of course, chapter 13. The entire chapter is dealing with the issue of charity. So another test of authenticity. Are the gifts being exercised with the spirit of charity? And then, of course, in chapter 14, we're going to look at the issue of edification. Here's another test that the Apostle Paul gives. Are the gifts of tongues especially causing division, or is it resulting in edification? So just kind of keep that in mind as we go through these various passages. So going back to verse 3, he begins here, wherefore I give you to understand that no man, now, who are the, quote, men? When Paul says no man, is he using it in a general sense? Does this apply to all people, to the entire world? Or, again, I'm a real stickler, is Paul referring to something more specific? Paul could be referring to no man in the assembly at Corinth, and that certainly would work, no man there at Corinth, or Paul could be referring to the pagan Gentiles back at verse 2. So, for example, reading verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man, now remember what he just wrote in verse 2, ye know that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. In other words, Paul could be referring to the pagan Gentiles. Listen, you have the pagan Gentiles that believe dumb idols. And we looked at those verses last lesson. When the Bible talks about dumb idols, it's not talking about an intelligence level or anything like that, but rather these idols have no capacity to communicate divine revelation. They're dumb in the sense that they do not communicate. They do not provide information. Here's the thing. Those pagan Gentiles are convinced that those dumb idols that are not revealing divine information or revelation, they're convinced that those objects, be it a pole, a rock, a piece of wood, a little statuette, they are carried away by their obsessive infatuation, by this internal influence, as well as the religious system and external influence. They're convinced that this inanimate object is talking, it is communicating, it is revealing supernatural information and divine revelation. But in reality, as the Bible describes, they are not. So if in verse 3, Paul is talking about no man, who of course, again, speaking by the Spirit of God, Paul probably is referring to those pagan Gentiles in verse 2. So, and again, I am pretty convinced that there is an element at Corinth. There are those within the ranks of the church who believe they possess these gifts. In reality, they're not driven by the Spirit of God, okay? So, by the way, I want to show you an example. If you go to the book of Acts, just be aware, in the book of Acts, you do see supernatural phenomena. You do see exorcists and sorcerers, and of course there are devils that are possessing individuals and so on and so forth. And just by way of illustration, the Apostle Paul has a run-in with a woman and an individual here. And it's a supernatural event, and Paul has a run-in, for example, here in Acts chapter 16. If we pick it up there at verse 16, Acts chapter 16, verse 16. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. Right, this individual, this damsel, supposedly possesses the spirit of divination. Now, interesting how the Apostle Paul is going to respond to this damsel. Verse 17, the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, that's in reference to the Apostle Paul, which show unto us the way of salvation. Verse 18, and this did she many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he, kind of interesting, the Spirit is male. You have a male spirit possessing a female. You talk about confusion regarding gender identity, just kind of interesting to note. At any rate, verse 18, the end of the verse, and he came out the same hour. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and threw them onto the marketplace, onto the ruler. So just be aware, there are those in possession of some sort of supernatural abilities, and Paul has run-ins with these individuals. So that doesn't mean they're genuine. That does not mean that this damsel was an authentic possessor of a God-given spiritual gift. In fact, the passages are describing some sort of a spirit in possession of this damsel. Paul commands the spirit to leave. So it would be rather odd to command the Holy Spirit to leave the damsel. So just be aware that there is a counterfeit program out there that are demonstrating some supernatural capabilities. So with that in mind, as we go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So if someone claims to possess a supernatural gift, the gift of healing, the gift of miracles, the gift of prophesying, the gift of dreams, the gift of tongues, what litmus test should a believer use to confirm the authenticity of the gift? That is it of God or is it something else? Verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit, capital S, obviously the Holy Spirit, speaking by the Spirit of God, calleth Jesus accursed. Again, now this is rather it's sort of out of the blue here. Keep this in mind. Sound doctrine is the measure by which you determine which spirit is driving the so-called gift or the supernatural phenomenon. And I know a lot of commentaries especially, they kind of bump into verse 3, and it just really does seem a strange passage. But we have some other verses that will obviously help us get a feel for what Paul is doing here. So here's the first test of authenticity. Is the one professing to possess the gift, what is he teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ? Now, the negative aspect, no man speaking. Now, by the way, the word speaking probably is referring to the gift of tongues. Not speaking in a general sense, but speaking in a more specific sense. Someone who speaks in tongues or is communicating information, claiming to be divine. Communicating revelation by dream, by prophesying, for example. They're going to say some things because they are driven and motivated by a so-called gift, supernatural phenomenon. But how do you know it's the real genuine deal? What are they teaching about Jesus Christ? And that is an important point to make. Now remember, in time past, the Gentiles believed there was all sorts of supernatural activity because of these dumb idols. They claim it's real, but it really isn't. Well, you have people that claim, I can dream a dream. I can prophesy. I can interpret. I have supernatural knowledge. I have supernatural wisdom. I can communicate with tongues. They can claim it. They can be convinced it's real, motivated by the Spirit of God. But just like the time past Gentiles, in reality, they do not. So anyway, what does Paul mean when he says, no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus? So wait a minute. Whatever gift is being exercised, what do they teach about the Lord Jesus Christ? Go over to 1 John chapter 4 and notice there is an interesting parallel, okay? First, it's not exactly the same thing here, but there is an interesting parallel. If we turn to 1 John chapter 4, we understand the context of 1 John, dual application. The doctrine ultimately is prophetic in nature, as John writes to equip the little flock to endure that 70th week of Daniel. Interestingly, 1 John provides tests. In this case, tests of fellowship. John is going to provide a series of tests for members of the remnant to identify who's the true believer and who's the fraud, who's the true member of the remnant and who is in actuality, an outsider. So just appreciate the context. First John provides a series of tests. And one of the tests that John in 1 John provides, again, for the little flock in relationship to the 70th week of Daniel, has to do with what is being taught, what is being communicated. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit. Now, that's not some sort of supernatural spirit, we're going to find out. It's an individual who's teaching. Okay, just a second. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. Because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye, now notice, the Spirit of God. Now keep your finger there. Remember, we just read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus something. Again, 1 John chapter 4, verse 2, whereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. So here's the litmus test. Here's the test of authenticity that John supplies for the members of the little flock. Listen, there are going to be a lot of teachers, a lot of prophets out there, false prophets, and they're going to teach that Jesus Christ, as revealed in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that the Jesus that Jesus Christ, as identified in the Gospels, is come in the flesh. You know if the teacher, the spirit, the prophet is genuine. Do they recognize that Jesus Christ came the first time as recorded in the Gospels? That is the way of determining the authenticity. That's what the Spirit of God is going to do. Provide accurate revelation and accurate information describing the identity of Jesus Christ. Now, look at verse 3. But every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. There are going to be prophets in that day that are going to teach that the account that is preserved in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the so-called first coming of Messiah in the person of Jesus Christ, is all fraudulent. It is not true. Remember, during the 70th week, that tribulational period, in the middle of the week, there will be that man of sin, son of perdition, that is going to rise and claim to be Israel's God. So the false message, the spirit of Antichrist, in fact, verse 3 again, every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus is come in the flesh, that's the first coming, is not of God. So remember, there's going to be a false curriculum claiming, listen, that Jesus of Nazareth, thousands of years previous, that was not Messiah. Now notice what John says. And this is the spirit of Antichrist. Technically, we, out of convenience, use the term Antichrist to refer to the man of sin and son of perdition. And okay, we understand that. When John refers to the Antichrist, it's talking about, he refers to it as the spirit of Antichrist. That is, the teaching, the system of revelation, the system of information is Antichrist, denying the first coming. Again, as we finish up verse 3, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is it in the world. So here is a similar parallel situation. In the future, the Spirit of God will teach accurate doctrine regarding the identity of Jesus Christ. He was Israel's Messiah. He did come, in our case, 2,000 years ago. He truly was sent from God. He is the anointed. He is the Lord. The Spirit of God will lead the prophets and the teaching ministries of various men to acknowledge that truth. the spirit of Antichrist will deny that that first coming appearance of Jesus ever occurred. Or I should say, the first coming of Messiah occurred in the person of Jesus Christ. Okay? Paul, he's talking to the Corinthians. He's writing the Corinthians. He says, you know what? The Spirit of God in the dispensation of the grace of God, the Spirit of God will lead someone who truly is in possession of the spiritual gifts to teach accurate doctrine regarding the person of Jesus Christ. By the way, what exactly is going on in verses 1 and 2? Very quickly, again, we want to appreciate the Spirit of God, Holy Spirit of God, as opposed to the false spirit, the spirit of Antichrist. The idea in verse 1, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits. Verse 2, hereby know ye the capital Spirit of God. Every small spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. If we turn back to chapter 2, look there, 1 John chapter 2, and notice there at verse 22. 1 John 2, verse 22, who is a liar but he that denieth Jesus is the Christ? He is an antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. The spirit that doesn't confess Jesus has come in the flesh is a liar. It's someone who is teaching that Jesus is not the Christ. Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 2, 2 Peter chapter 2, and notice there at verse 1, but there are false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. So, here's the point. In the future, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, will recognize and identify through the teaching ministries of men that that first coming really happened. Jesus of Nazareth is Messiah. The false spirit, the spirit of Antichrist, denounces the Lord Jesus Christ as being the true Messiah. Jesus was a fraud. He was a counterfeit. Here's my point. The litmus test, the test of authenticity, has everything to do with the doctrine revolving around Jesus Christ. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So the first test has to do with sound doctrine. If somebody claims, I can dream dreams, I can prophesy, I can speak in tongues, I can provide a word of knowledge, so on and so forth. Wait a minute. It must be measured by sound doctrine. And Brother Richard, he said it a few weeks ago, one of the core reasons we need to reject the charismatic movement, fundamentally, number one, the core reason is there is no doctrinal integrity behind it. Their system is based upon emotion. It's based upon experience. We always want to use God's word. So that's why verse 3 of chapter 12, 1 Corinthians, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking, whether by tongues, prophesying, dreams, word of knowledge, so on and so forth, speaking by the Spirit of God, calleth Jesus accursed. That's the negative aspect. Keep reading. And that no man, again, who are they, those time past Gentiles, the pagans out there? No man can say that Jesus is the Lord. So there's the positive aspect. The Spirit of God will teach some accurate things about Jesus Christ being the Lord. And also, if someone is truly motivated by the gift, they will never call Jesus Christ accursed. Now, that's where things get a little bit maybe unclear here. In what sense would someone call or teach that Jesus Christ is accursed? And in what sense would someone in possession of a spiritual gift call Jesus Lord? Well, if we sort of get a feel for, again, what's going on at Corinth, and if we remember what we saw last time, one of the reasons for the gifts, the supernatural gifts, the spiritual gifts, are for the confirmation and testimony of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Corinthians possess these gifts, number one, as a means of provoking the nation of Israel. God is using the Corinthians to communicate to the nation of Israel, unbelieving Israel, that they are cast away, that they have fallen. And God is now using the, in this case, the Corinthians, as a means of provocation, demonstrating to the nation of Israel, God's doing something with the Gentiles. Israel now has fallen. They are no longer God's favored nation, dispensationally, okay? The second reason that the gifts were given, again, was intended to confirm, that is to testify, that Jesus rose from the dead. Real quickly, go back to Acts chapter 1. Go back to Acts chapter 1. We saw these verses last lesson, but just be mindful. The ability to perform these various supernatural phenomena is to confirm, wait a minute, there is something being taught about Jesus Christ. And the gifts, the supernatural phenomena, is intended to confirm the message. In the Bible, the gifts are intended to confirm or affirm a message. In this case, something about the Lord Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 1, if you recall there at verse 8, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, "But ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you," notice, "and ye shall be witnesses unto me." Just notice the correlation here. Wait for the power of the Holy Ghost. Obviously, that's a reference to Acts chapter 2, where when the Holy Ghost comes down as a mighty rushing wind. And of course, there's these cloven tongues of fire, and all of these apostles start speaking in tongues. Just recognize the correlation. Verse 8. You're going to receive power. That's the Holy Ghost power, Acts chapter 2. "After the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me." Gifts confirm the message. Go over to chapter 4 and just notice again this correlation. Acts chapter 4, and notice there at verse 10. Acts chapter 4, verse 10. "Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole." Peter just performed a miracle. And you can begin reading that earlier on. Verse 9, there was an impotent man. So without getting into the details, verse 9, there is an impotent man. Peter heals this man. And after Peter heals the impotent man, what does he say in verse 10? "Be it known unto you and to all the people of Israel, by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God has raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here." This supernatural capacity to heal an impotent man is now going to confirm and testify to the identity, the person of Jesus Christ. And there's always going to be this correlation. If you turn over, drop down to verse 31, chapter 4, verse 31. "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken, where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost." Drop down to verse 33. "And with great power," that's the power of the Holy Ghost, "gave the apostles witnesses of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ." So just think about this. They are in possession of this Holy Ghost power, the ability to perform miracles, dreams and visions and prophesying, as Acts 2 describes, according to Joel chapter 2, that God's going to pour out the Spirit in those days, and his sons and his daughters are going to perform various supernatural feats. Why? Again, to witness concerning the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Look at the end of verse 33. And great grace was upon them all. You got to go back to Zechariah chapter 12, and you'll identify exactly what that grace, the grace has to do with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Again, manifesting himself through signs and wonders for the purpose of witnessing to the resurrection. One more verse, chapter 5, and we read there in chapter 5, look there at verse 30, chapter 5, verse 30, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Verse 32, and we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. Again, verse 32, we're his witnesses, so is the Holy Ghost. How is the Holy Ghost witnessing? Through supernatural phenomena. The gifts. The gifts confirm the message. Specifically, the gifts confirm the message that Jesus rose from the dead. Now, go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. When we understand the reason, one of the reasons why the Corinthians possess these gifts. Chapter 1, Paul tells us to testify. The Corinthians are supposed to testify to the nation of Israel. Jesus rose from the dead. There are those who rejected the doctrine of resurrection. When we look at the word accursed, we find that that word has to do with Jesus being cut off from the land of the living. It has to do with Jesus not being raised from the dead. Chapter 12, verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed. In what way? Remember the gifts, testify to the resurrection. Interesting. The word accursed, or for that matter, another form, the word curse, has to do with someone being judicially punished by the hand of God. Someone who is judicially punished because of the wrath of God. Go to Galatians, and before we go to Galatians, just keep this in mind. After Paul is through addressing the spiritual gifts, chapters 12, 13, and 14, Paul is going to devote an entire chapter, chapter 15, defending the doctrine of resurrection, and just as importantly, defending the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We'll look at a couple of verses. The doctrine of resurrection was revolting to the Greeks. We'll see that in just a second. But go over to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. And if you think about, well, wait a minute. The Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit of God, would never call Jesus accursed. There are those who profess to possess the gifts that are teaching that Jesus died, not as a propitiation, but he died as a mere mortal man. In other words, Jesus was a real individual, but Jesus, he died as a consequence of just judgment because he was just a mere mortal man. Jesus was justly executed, not as the God-man, not as God's propitiation for the sins of the world, but he was justly punished as a mere mortal who was worthy of execution. But he never rose from the dead. If you notice in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, now I'll never forget this, you know, verse 13, not a good number, you understand, Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made, notice, a curse for us. For it is written, accursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Now, wait a minute. Paul tells us Jesus was made accursed. the Spirit of God would never lead someone to say or teach that Jesus was accursed. And remember, those claiming to possess the gifts, there's a doctrine that denies that we're going to see Jesus rose from the dead. Now, when we read that Jesus Christ was made a curse for us, that takes us back to Deuteronomy chapter 21. And if we go back to Deuteronomy chapter 21, we see the Apostle Paul pulling from Deuteronomy chapter 21 some doctrine regarding, well, what does it mean when someone is cursed, specifically cursed by God? Deuteronomy chapter 21, what we have here is information, a law governing a rebellious son, interestingly enough. How do you deal with a rebellious son? And the consequence, the judgment here, is obviously very, very severe. I mean, Deuteronomy 21, verse 18. If a man have a stubborn and rebellious son. Well, now there is a means of justice and so on and so forth. And ultimately, verse 22. And if a man have committed a sin worthy of death, and he be put to death, and thou hang him on a tree, verse 23, his body shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day. For he that is hanged is accursed of God. Paul is pulling from Deuteronomy 21, and you know, Jesus, he was nailed to a tree, and he hung there on a tree. He hung there as the object of God's wrath, and he hangs there as a testimony of God punishing him. Now, here in Deuteronomy 21, the one who committed the transgression worthy of death, well, that individual is hung on a tree as a testimony to the nation of Israel that he was cursed by God or accursed of God. Verse 23 again, for he that is hanged is accursed of God, that thy land be not defiled, which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance. Jesus was accursed. Cursed is the word Paul uses in Galatians chapter 3. He took our place. Never deny the doctrine of substitution. Jesus substituted himself for the sinner. He became the object of God's curse against rebellion, transgression, and sin. Jesus wasn't mere mortal man who became accursed or cursed by God. He was cursed by God as the object of sin. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us that Jesus was made sin for us. So we understand that the Lord Jesus, he did die as an object of God's curse. But what's the difference between Jesus being the object of God's curse or any other mere mortal man? Jesus rose from the dead 3 days later. There is a doctrine being taught that Jesus was accursed, and he never rose from the dead. Go now to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and notice what Paul is going to correct there at Corinth. Paul, of course, is rebuking the Corinthians. In chapter 15, he's going to provide corrective doctrine. We understand that. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, notice there, at verse 12. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12. Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? Just remember this. When Paul says the Spirit of God would never lead anybody to say that Jesus is accursed. That is, he died as an object of God's wrath. But he was nothing more than a man. He died because of his own sins. And because of that, he didn't rise from the dead. Paul, he knows that is a doctrine that has seeped into the assembly there at Corinth. That's why he devotes this entire chapter. So again, verse 12, chapter 15. Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. It's of no worth. There is no value. There is no effect. Verse 15, yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. So, wait a minute. The Spirit of God, it would never teach that Jesus was a mere mortal man who died for his own sins, and the proof is he never rose from the dead. Wait a minute. The Spirit of God would teach that Jesus is Lord. If there is no resurrection, and Paul, he kind of summarizes it in verse 17, if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, ye are yet in your sins. Go to Galatians chapter 2. Notice here in Galatians chapter 2. And notice at verse 21, Galatians chapter 2, verse 21, I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. We're not going to talk about the context. But if Jesus isn't the means for righteousness, so on and so forth, if he's not the means of righteousness, the verse says Christ is dead in vain. It does not say Christ died, past tense, in vain. There's a difference. What's the difference between Christ died in vain or Christ is dead in vain? He's referring, if Christ is not the means for justification and imputed righteousness, Christ is, present tense, still dead in vain. That's the point Paul is making here. Then Christ is dead. Not has died, past tense. He is still dead. So when we kind of understand what the Apostle Paul here is pressing, go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, but I also wanted to read Acts chapter 17. This is something interesting about the Greeks, specifically Athens. If you go to Acts chapter 17, the Greeks, they had a problem with the doctrine of resurrection. We're familiar with the Sadducees. The Sadducees, they didn't believe in resurrection. Well, the Greeks, they were repulsed by the idea that people could rise from the dead. They denied literal, physical, biological resurrection, okay? And the Greek culture, they had a real problem with that. I only mention it because, obviously, we know where Corinth is, okay? In Acts chapter 17, if you notice there at verse 22, then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that that in all things ye are too superstitious. And so Paul, he goes on and he describes the altar to the unknown God, so on and so forth. And in light of all of that, notice what he is preaching. Verse 31, because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. Verse 32. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them. You know what ended the meeting? Paul had an audience. Paul, he's preaching away. He's talking about this God who seeks, that all men repent, and God's, at the time of ignorance, he's winking at, so on and so forth. As soon as Paul made reference to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the meeting ended. The point is this: there is this doctrine regarding resurrection, specifically denying the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And if we look at verse 3 in light of that, it works a whole lot better. So when we read chapter 12, verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man, again, here's the test of authenticity, here's the litmus test. It doesn't matter if somebody claims to possess supernatural abilities and gifts and so on and so forth. What are they saying about Jesus Christ? If it's empowered and driven by God the Holy Spirit, the measure is the doctrine. They're not going to say Jesus was a mere mortal who was cursed and never rose from the dead. The end of verse 3, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Let's keep it in the context of resurrection. Being accursed, he's dead, mere mortal, he justly deserved punishment, but he's still in the ground. He is still dead. Well, wait a minute. The flip side is, if it's by the Spirit of God, the doctrine would say, Jesus is Lord. Now, not in a general sense. We understand Jesus Christ is the Lord, but keep it in light of the context here regarding death and resurrection. Paul, when he describes the Lord Jesus Christ, it does affirm his resurrection. Go to chapter 15 again, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And if you notice, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and look there at verse 47, chapter 15, verse 47. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Paul's talking about resurrection. In fact, the entire chapter, resurrection. Verse 47 describes Jesus Christ as the Lord from heaven. What made the second man unique? What made the second man different? What is the distinguishing characteristic of the second man? Paul calls him the last Adam. You have the first Adam and you have the first man. Well, Adam, the first man, he died and he remains dead physically. The distinguishing characteristic regarding Jesus Christ is, wait a minute, he's the Lord, and as the last Adam and the second man, he rose from the dead. In fact, look at the end of chapter 15 here in verse 57. In light of resurrection, the entire chapter devoted to resurrection, verse 57. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory, that is, from the dead. That's the context. Through our, here we go, Lord Jesus. He is Lord in a specific way. He's the Lord of life. He's the Lord of resurrection. Go to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. His resurrection testifies to his identity. For example, Romans chapter 1, and look there at verse 4. Now, we should read verse 3. Romans chapter 1, verse 3. Concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. What is the proof, the evidence, the litmus test that demonstrates Jesus is no ordinary man? Well, he's the Lord, and we know that by the resurrection from the dead. 1 Timothy chapter 1. Again, when the Apostle Paul identifies Jesus Christ as the Lord, there it's used in a couple of these verses in a specific way, in reference to who he is as the God of life and the God of resurrection. 1 Timothy chapter 1. And notice there at verse 17. Let's just read verse 17. Now unto the King eternal, immortal. Now, Jesus is the only one who is immortal. Obviously, the Father isn't immortal because he doesn't possess mortality, mortal flesh kind of thing. Again, reference to Jesus Christ. Now on to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Paul is emphasizing his immortality. Jesus will never be subject to death ever again. He had a body of flesh that did die. He was raised from the dead, hence he is now immortal. Go to chapter 6. And in light of that, chapter 6, verse 14. That thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall show who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto. So the Apostle Paul, a number of times, he emphasizes who Jesus is as Lord, and the proof of his lordship is his resurrection. One more verse in that regard, 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and notice there at verse 8. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. Remember that Jesus Christ was of the seed of David, was raised from the dead according to my gospel. Paul's gospel teaches some things regarding the unique consequence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it has everything to do with his right to be the only potentate, Lord of lords, King of kings, so on and so forth. Okay, so with that, let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The second evidence that Paul's going to provide. Well, once again, how do you determine if someone who professes to have the gift, someone who professes to possess these gifts, how do you determine if those gifts are being driven by the Holy Spirit or are they being driven by the spirit of the flesh, by another spirit? Okay, we saw already verse 3, the doctrine fundamentally is the litmus test. The measure is what is being taught about Jesus. Specifically, is he Lord, the one who was raised from the dead? Was he a mere mortal, accursed? And he's still in the ground, as it were. Now Paul, verses 4 through 6, is going to provide another evidence. This is how you can determine who's who, who's real, who's genuine, who's authentic, who's a fraud, who's a counterfeit. Paul's now going to concentrate on unity. And in verses 4, 5, and 6, unity specifically among the Godhead. Now remember, we've seen so many verses all over 1 Corinthians. One horrible problem at Corinth was division. We understand that assembly was fragmented. There was all sorts of segregation and so on. And we know that they had a problem with division. Paul's going to emphasize unity, and he's going to hit it hard in chapter 12 especially. So what Paul's going to do now, verse 4. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. Just notice the unity among the Godhead. If you notice verse 4, reference to God the Holy Spirit. Verse 5, reference to the Lord, that is the Lord Jesus Christ, as we just saw in verse 3. Again, verse 3, no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. And then verse 6, and there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God. So you have the triune, the Godhead. You have, of course, God the Holy Spirit. You have the Lord Jesus Christ, and then you have God the Father. What Paul's going to emphasize is the three members of the Godhead, they work in seamless synchronization. The three members of the Godhead, they operate in organized harmony. Now, why would Paul do that? The activities at Corinth in the name of spiritual gifts, the behavior of the Corinthians in the exercise of their spiritual gifts does not reflect this seamless, cooperative, harmonious work. In other words, just envision what's going on at Corinth. You have some individuals claiming that gift, other individuals claiming another gift. And you know what? There's no cohesion. Instead, you find there is conflict, there is competition. If this is truly the work of God, anyone who professes to possess these gifts, and remember, you got the frauds out there, they can convince themselves that they have the gifts, bunch of dumb Gentiles, dumb idols, that doesn't make it real. Well, wait a minute, here's the next evidence. Are the possessors of these gifts working together with this synchronized view of cohesive work and operation? Or is everybody just sort of arbitrarily doing their own thing? And by the way, Paul is going to emphasize, you guys, there's a lot of confusion there. Do all things decently and in order. God is not the author of confusion. The behavior at Corinth is not reflecting what is true of how the Godhead operates. I want to just emphasize, in verses 4, notice in verse 4 again, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. The end of verse 5, the same Lord. The middle of verse 6, the same God. If you notice down at verse 11, but all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit. Verse 12, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all members of that one body being many are one body. Verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Over and over again. Verse 20, notice in verse 20, but now are they many members, yet but one body. Verse 25, that there should be no schism in the body, but that all members should have the same care. One for over and over again, Paul, he is highlighting and reiterating the oneness, the sameness, this like-minded operation that is true of the person of the Godhead and how the body of Christ is designed, so on and so forth. Why is he doing that? If you aren't operating in synchronized harmony, if instead you're combating one another and there is conflict, well, wait, that's the litmus test. Another test of authenticity is, are you guys working together, or are the gifts being exercised and manifested independent of others? Listen, this wasn't supposed to be a flesh fest. Well, when I got this gift, I'm better than you. My gift is more superior than you. Your gift is inferior to me. And it becomes sort of a competition that defies the very principle that the Godhead abides by. And that is unity. And that is like-mindedness. And that is sameness, if you will, as Paul uses that terminology. So real quickly, for the minute we have, notice we have the gifts of God the Holy Spirit. Then Paul describes the administrations of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he describes the operations of God, God the Father. And one way to perhaps view this, I'm going to use a rough illustration here. And I'm going to talk about skill sets. View it this way. The Holy Spirit, he, by the way, we're going to look at it next time. He's the one who decides who gets what gift. There's a, you know, if you notice in verse 11, in verse 11, but all these worketh the one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally, notice, as he will. Now that kind of, defies the idea of trying to seek whatever gift you might be in possession of. The Holy Spirit, he's the one who provides a certain skill set. I'm going to use the language skill set. God the Holy Spirit decides, okay, here's the gift for so-and-so, here's the gift for so-and-so, right? So if you can just envision, there are folks that possess various skill sets, talents, abilities, okay? But wait a minute. Those individual gifts are not intended to be given in a vacuum. God didn't say, hey, you got the gift of tongues, now go lock yourself in the closet and exercise the gift of tongues. You've got the gift of prophesying. You've got the gift of dreams, so on and so forth. God didn't give those gifts in a vacuum. He never intended those gifts to be exercised for one's own personal enjoyment or for one's own self-gratification. That's where the idea of administrations come from. We use the language administering medication, administer justice, administer a shot. Technically, the word means to tender, to provide, to serve. In other words, if God the Holy Spirit grants certain gifts to certain individuals within the ranks of the church at Corinth, wait a minute, it's to be tempered with the understanding that those gifts are intended to serve. We'll look at that next time. That is, you have certain gifts there at Corinth, which is intended to be applied in certain functions, roles, and ministries. Okay? So we'll look at some of that next time. Those gifts are not given in a vacuum. It's intended to serve. And that's where Paul uses the word administrations. Then Paul, he goes further and he talks about the operations of God. The operations of God provides the, if I can call it, the guidelines, the order, the organization, the standards, the rules, the guidelines. So all three work in perfect harmony. At Corinth, everything is confusion. You don't have people exercising the gifts in light of the administrations, which has to do with serving and functioning in service for others, nor is it being under the influence and operation of the Father, who provides the overall purpose and plan and wise guidance. So we'll see how all three of this work together. The problem at Corinth is this, and that's why Paul provides the second test of authenticity. Are the gifts, if they're truly driven by the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit of God, all of this activity is working in perfect synchronized harmony? It isn't happening at Corinth. Paul is saying that isn't the Spirit of God. Okay? Well, we're going to stop. We're going to take a little break. We're going to have our second meeting beginning at 12:45. Father, again, we do thank you for your grace and for your love. As always, we thank you for your word. And as we continue to study it, may we have a little more light and understanding. And most importantly, may we know how it is we're to respond to you today in the current dispensation of grace. And we, of course, ask in Christ Jesus' name.